That concludes the debate on reconsidering highly protected marine areas. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is an urgent question, and I call Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further explanation of the removal of the previously announced £46 million of funding for universities and colleges in Scotland.
Minister Graham Day.
We currently face the most difficult public spending environment since devolution, and we've been clear that government will have to make difficult choices to address new pressures in the education and skills portfolio since the 2023-24 budget announcement, which is the explanation for this decision. The £46 million funding was not part of the core allocations for colleges and universities, which the Scottish Funding Council published on the 13th of April. This funding was intended to enable strategic change in the sectors, additional funding for which will be reconsidered if and when the government's financial position allows. This decision returns funding for universities and colleges to the previously announced flat cash settlement in line with the resource spending review. Despite the current challenges and extreme pressures, we continue to spend nearly £2 billion on Scotland's colleges and universities, demonstrating our continued commitment to tertiary education. Now, I understand that this is disappointing news for colleges and universities, and it has added to the challenges they face. We are therefore engaging with the Scottish Funding Council as well as the college and university sectors to ensure that institutions can achieve financial stability. And I have also spoken directly with Colleges Scotland and University Scotland today on this matter.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, this is the last thing that our country needs right now. Professor Dame Sally Mapstone, University of Scotland, says it's dismaying that we are told that higher education is being deprioritised by the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government cannot keep expecting to have world-class universities on the cheap. Shona Struthers of Colleges Scotland says of the clawback, it's inexplicable. Ministers are relying on colleges to provide hundreds of thousands of students with training and education each year, but with less and less funding, it simply can't be done anymore. Now, Presiding Officer, I believe from our time together on the Education, Children and Young People Committee that the Minister genuinely wants to support Scotland's colleges and universities. But I do wonder if he's had a personality transplant, because one of his first acts on his return as a Minister is to put the equivalent of a dagger at the heart of Scottish higher and further education. What did they tell him about the real-world consequences of this drastic funding cut?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, there's an element or a portrayed element of surprise, shock, in Mr Kerr's presentation, and I still don't understand that. Because the fact that the education portfolio has had to revisit its original budget planning can come as no surprise to Mr Kerr, nor any other member of the Education Committee of the Parliament. Not only do we face the same pressures as other portfolio areas brought about by the appalling mismanagement of the UK economy by the Tories, we also provided local government with substantial financial assistance in order that they reached a pay settlement with teachers, something opposition politicians led by Stephen Kerr demanded repeatedly that we assist in securing. The then Cabinet Secretary for Education was crystal clear to Mr Kerr and other members at the Education Committee back in February that the funds involved would have to be found from within the portfolio budget. So either what we have here is an attack of selective amnesia on the part of Mr Kerr, or perish the thought, the very worst of opposition politicking. Mr Kerr can't have it both ways. The same money can't be spent twice.
Stephen Kerr.
I also think that the Minister is better than the reply he just gave. And by the way, nobody told Ross Greer, another member of our committee, who was busy tweeting the day before how proud he was about the £46 million he'd managed to procure for the sector from the government. So there's something not quite joined up about any of this. It was only on December the 15th that John Swinney, with much fanfare, promised £46 million more for universities and colleges. He said, we must have a skills, training and research environment that enables our people and businesses to realise their potential. And ironically, it was on me, an intervention that I put to the then Deputy First Minister. He said, I also point out to Mr Kerr, as part of the budget, he did not welcome this bit. More resources have been allocated to universities and colleges, which obviously contribute to the skills opportunities and capacities of our country. That's John Swinney. That was 20 weeks ago. So what has changed? Was John Swinney wrong to allocate the money? How can Scotland's colleges and universities be expected to plan for the long term, fulfil the vital function that is in their power to deliver for our country when they are faced with this total betrayal?
Minister.
Presiding officer, so not only selective amnesia and inability to listen to an answer, I was very clear about what has changed. But going back to Mr Kerr's point, second point, he's right. This does set challenges for the colleges sector. And I have spoken, as I said, at length today with Colleges Scotland and University Scotland. Next week, I'll be meeting with the Colleges Scotland chief executives, separately with the colleges principals and chairs, and then University Scotland. So there's going to be considerable dialogue about how we collectively can address, as I acknowledge, the challenges that this regrettable decision has created for them.
Nicole Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government has thrown further and higher education into chaos by continually failing to provide answers on funding. It's given at least three different explanations to Scottish Labour on what this funding could have been used for, including supporting transition to a financially sustainable system, supporting skills, training and research, and future-proofing the sector. The Government itself identified these challenges, so can the Minister tell us how he expects the sector to address any of these challenges in the absence of the funding it was promised?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the funding was intended to support transitioning the sectors to a more sustainable footing. And of course, this decision makes that more difficult. And that's why I'm engaging directly with the sector on this, to identify ways of moving forward on it. But I do just say gently to Pam Duncan-Glancy, if, God forbid, Labour ever found themselves in government, they'd be faced with making difficult financial decisions like this in education. Well, perhaps not, because if reports are to be believed, they favour tuition fees, although I suspect the students of Scotland would have something to say about that.
And I call Ben McPherson.
The Minister's already spoken about the difficult financial environment that we're experiencing since devolution in 1999, with multiple shared challenges and demands on the public purse. Therefore, can the Minister advise what analysis in this decision the Scottish Government has done to quantify the impact of external factors in this scenario, including Brexit and the UK Government's 2022 mini-budget? What effect has that had on financing our colleges and universities?
Presiding Officer, I hear the Conservatives groaning. How predictable. There's no doubt that Scotland continues to feel the effects of Brexit and the impact of the UK Government spending decisions. I spent much of this week with the university sector, and I hear the pain that they are suffering as a result, continuing pain as a result of Brexit. Scotland's losing out on hundreds of millions of pounds in EU funding due to Brexit, including losing access to the £26 billion Erasmus Plus programme due to the UK Government decision not to participate. While the Scottish Government is doing what it can with its limited powers to ensure we provide the services people need, the UK Government could do far more to ease the burden affecting so many.
Willie Rennie.
Last week, the head of University of Scotland described the SNP Government's university policy as managed decline. In response, the Minister then said he was listening to universities and colleges. This week, he cuts £46 million from their budget. Is the Minister sure he was listening? Does the Minister think these cuts will end that managed decline?
Minister.
So once again, Presiding Officer, as with Stephen Kerr, selective amnesia, because Willie Rennie is also a member of the Education Committee. And he sat there, he heard Shirley-Ann Somerville explain that the funding for the teachers' pay settlement would have to be found within the education budget. And I don't know from where he thought that was going to come. But to go back to his point about engagement and listening to the universities, as I said, I'll be meeting all of them next week, and I am very open-minded, both in terms of the college sector and the university sector, to any suggestions they have about flexibility. As well, you already know, we've talked about this on committee in recent months. Any suggestions they have will be listened to.
Thank you. That concludes the urgent question. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 8795. In the name of George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion, and the question is that motion 8795 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 8796 on a committee substitute and 8797 on designation of a lead committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm both moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. There are eight questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 8764.2, in the name of George Adam, which seeks to amend motion 8764, in the name of Douglas Ross, on transparency of Scotland's governing party, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No. Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.